Private game down here. That's going to be a novice map this week. Nice. Now you can see the group, your competitive settings. Normally you launch the game, but if you want to just go by yourself and check it out, you can go back to the TagPro, play now, and now you can enter the game, the map by yourself, and check it out. All right, let's go back to the slide show. Okay, figured out how to do that. So we went through that. You know how to set up your own scrim, or if you want to check out the maps by yourself. This is a weird one for people that are new to Competitive Tag Pro. There's all these different tweaks on... Here it is. All the different tweaks. So I'm used to just playing pubs, public groups all the time. And this is Audacity on the left in pubs. What we play in competition is Audacity 2. So I was telling my team, you see that 45-degree angle there in the middle. You can bounce off that and cap. In pubs, you can't do that. It's just a square block. So there's a lot of different... little differences on the maps. That's why scrims are really important. And just practicing, getting used to Competitive Tag Pro. Moving on to number 4. Also a big deal. You don't know if the bombs are spawning or there's no warning. There's no blinking lights. They just show up. So you got to keep track of everything in your own head. It's a big thing with your team communicating the pup times. Those are the basics. But here is an example. We are gonna switch over to the example. So we'll start at the beginning. 6 minutes. Pups are spawning soon. Clue is going to go get this tag pro because he knows the pup timer. Comes over. Clue gets it. Boom. Grabs it. Kills Strider. And there's no blinking warning there. So that everybody knows that. But if you know the pup timers, it's huge. You can use boosts. You can use your momentum. You can dominate the game if you're keeping track of that better than most people. And we are back to the slideshow. Sorry, kind of clunky. All right, now on to the more in-depth things. Anti-regrab. This is something I never played in pubs in my life before. Because I want to help the team out, and I'm thinking I need to go chase down the flag carrier and get a return if I'm playing defense. But on anti-regrab, it's huge in competitive tag pro. So there's a picture here. Clue is playing anti-regrab on Agnes, and the flag is out. And he's just making sure when his teammates get the return, he's going to be reset, and it's not going to be a constant regrab train where they're just chasing for the whole game. So let's switch to the examples real quick. And this was Freak last week in Miners. Freak, you see the red team. Awuga has the flag. Nobody's on regrab right now. But watch this whole play develop and what Freak does. Awuga comes down, spikes himself, unfortunately. Freak immediately goes back for anti-regrab. Vader still gets the grab, but Freak's there to clean it up and clears the way, cleans it up so Scrapper can get that cap. So that's going to be huge all season. You're probably going to hear it all the time from your captains. Anti, anti, anti. We need anti. Hit the flags out. Back to the slides. That was a good example, Freak. Let's go to the bad example. And the Portland Tile Blazers are going to hate this because this is from week one of their game. All right. So we are playing the Arctic Ice Caps, week one, Portland Tile Blazers. 1-1 game. Watch how quickly this can spiral if you don't have anti-re and you aren't getting a reset. So Agnes has the flag, and they're going to score. They're going to capture. Boom. Capture. No anti. Corduroy gets an immediate grab and going to cap again. And then look, no regrab. And just a train. 3 caps in a matter of 20 seconds. Until finally Smalley Biggs says we need regrab, or we need anti-regrab, so he stops that play. Watch it again, real bad. That's how a game can flip on its head if you don't get a reset, you're not prepared. It's almost better to give up 1 cap and make sure you have anti than just to keep chasing. Back to the slideshow. Feel free to jump in if you have any thoughts about anti-re. To me, it still is like, it's not very intuitive because you feel like you're not helping your team that much if you're just spawning and waiting when the flag's not there. But it's actually super helpful. You got to have somebody on anti-re. Moving on. OD. Never had heard this phrase before. Just means offense, defense. And when you're playing for fun, you're just playing for pubs, and you go on offense, you're just like, my job is to cap. That's my only job. I'm going to get the flag, bring it back, and get all the glory from having all these captures. In competitive, you've got to know if your flag is out or not. If your flag is out, you do not want to be grabbing. You want to be on defense preparing for them. So you need, that's where the whole team effort comes into play. You need your defenders to tell you where the flag is if they're out, and as an offender, you've got a lot more responsibility. You got to get the flag back, and you got to get reset before you can even think about capping yourself. So here is a good example of that. Here we are. We're back to novice week one. And Smalley Biggs has the flag. He's going to get tagged. And we'll see how it plays out. So he gets tagged, and immediately Bambi is in a pass three situation. And so Charlie's the only red ball that's in front of the flag right now. So his team's telling him, hey, pass three, pass three. And Charlie makes that play to save the cap. So that's what OD, you're going to hear that a lot. Offense, defense. But if Charlie were to grab on that one-on-one situation, that could have been bad if he got tagged immediately. So you always have to be aware, not going to flaccid when the flag's out. I'm going to play OD if I'm an offender. Headed back to the slides. All right, the last couple things are all have to do with power-ups. I'm sure we're going to talk more about power-ups in the coming week. I'm no expert at all, but the biggest difference to me from competitive to just regular pubs was how important power-ups really are. That's something that Vader and Gospel Juke just pounded into my head. You gotta win the power-ups. They're huge. So before, I was never getting double-digit power-ups when I would play pubs, and now I'm consistently getting 15%. And this is my unofficial power rankings that people may disagree with. I think TagPro is the most important power-up, followed by Rolling Bomb and Juke Juice. It's going to depend on the situation. It's going to depend if you're playing offense or defense. Feel free to jump in one way or the other. Cooler agrees with this rankings. I like that. But they're huge. We had a game this past week, Portland Tile Blazers. We lost by one cap the whole game. And can't see the stream. Let's see if I share the screen one more time. Hopefully you can see it now. So we had a game. We lost by one. Portland Tile Blazers did. But we were lost the pup battle 16-2. I've never seen that bad in my life. So it was shocking we were able to keep it that close with a 16-2 loss on the pups. Moving on, more about how to effectively use power-ups. Juke Juice, there's kind of an order of operations is how I look at it. Let's say you win Juke Juice, and the last thing you want to do is run to regrab. And just sit on regrab while the Juke Juice wastes away. You only have 20 seconds with this pup. So to me, you want to be a chaser. If you get a Juke Juice, you want to go get a reset. Chase the enemy flag carrier. If you can't do that, you want to be the flag carrier. Or a defender once you get a reset. And then, like I said, kind of as a last resort, just to wait on regrab if your team does not have that covered. With your tag pro, you want to not grab the flag. You want your teammate to grab the flag, and then you're just going to guide them back for a capture and protect them. I'm a really bad tag pro lead. My only trick is you got to go a little bit slower than you think, so you stay connected to the flag carrier. And the last, of course, is a rolling bomb, which is great if you're a flag carrier. You never want to boost if you have rolling bomb. And you have the flag, because if you boost, you could get double tapped pretty easily. And I didn't realize that you can actually use Rolling Bomb on defense. I always thought it was a cardinal sin to go to defense with a Rolling Bomb, but it can actually be really effective on defense. Cooler added, don't focus on tagging, just create a path with Tag Pro lead. Yes, that's important. Sometimes you want to rack up the tags and the returns and just start tagging everybody you see. But if you just clear a path through your flag carrier, that's going to be the most effective way to do it. So let's look at how you can use the rolling bomb on defense real quick. All right. Here we are. Back to Portland Tile Blazers, week one. Moonbase. Morpheus wins the rolling bomb down here. Let's see how it plays out. So, all three of his teammates are on offense right now. So instead of Morpheus rushing to offense, he says, I'm going to keep this on defense. He's blocking Zumi, and the rest of his teammates, they all die. They can't get out. So if he doesn't stay back, that's a pass four. That's going to be a cap for the red team. But instead, he stays back for defense, and he actually defuses it, kills the flag carrier, and gets a reset for his team. So, yeah, we can definitely use rolling bomb on defense, and I would recommend it in certain situations. What else? So, back to the final two things I wish I would have known sooner. The importance of staying ahead. You're probably going to hear this a lot as you play competitive tag pro. Just stay ahead. Just stay ahead. What does that mean exactly? To use a sports analogy, I'll probably use a couple as we wind down. But if you ever play basketball and they tell you to play defense, so just like stay between your man and the basket. That's how you play defense. And that's kind of how I think about staying ahead. You want to stay in between the flag and the enemy flag carrier. You're staying ahead of the play. One thing people will do is they'll get a return and then they'll rush back. You don't want to rush back if you don't know where the enemy flag carrier is, because all your momentum will be going the wrong way. They'll get around you. And you don't want to boost backwards. That is a kind of a cardinal sin. If you boost backwards and you whiff, you miss it, that puts your team in a tough situation. So, yep. And then the baseball analogy. Surely this moves baseball up a ranking. Not a lot of people like baseball, but I played baseball growing up. And as an outfielder, they always said your first step has to be backwards if you don't 100% know where the ball is, because you got to read where it is. And the worst thing you can do is take a step forward and the ball's over your head. All your momentum is forward and you can't go get it. That's what happens in Tag Pro all the time, is people will swipe. They'll have their momentum going the wrong way and they're not staying ahead of the play. Let's look at a quick example here. We're almost done. Feel free to have any questions or jump in. Here is another highlight play for Morpheus. He's chasing Life of Nurse here. Chasing. And what I would commonly do, and I think what most people would do when they're first playing competitive tag pro, is chase Life of Nurse. We want to get this return. We can feel the return coming and we just want to go get it. Morpheus makes a smart play, backs off and says, no, I'm going to stay ahead of the play. Stay between the flag carrier and where he can cap. Stays ahead, contains, so his teammate Clue can come clean it up and they get a reset. So that's just stay ahead of the play right there. Savvy veteran play. And we are wrapping up here. I mostly play defense, so I'm not going to be an expert here on when you should and shouldn't grab. Flaccid grabs, according to the Tag Pro League website, is a grab where you die within 2 seconds of grabbing the flag. So basically just a quick grab, nothing happens, you die. You don't want to do that, obviously. And you want to work as a team with your offensive partner. One common mistake is somebody will go out, they think they have a grabbing opportunity, grab. Their teammate won't be there to block for them. Their teammate won't be there for a handoff situation. Just makes it a lot easier to contain and get the reset if you grab one-on-one or 1v2. And common thing, everybody does it, but if you're mad about a play, you make a mistake, you're just furious, you want to get down there, grab as soon as you can, that's when you start tilting. And we we've talked a little bit about the advanced stats of Gasp and Nish. It can be pretty new for everybody. It's not the end-all be-all. It's not saying this player is the best player in Tag Pro because they have a 10 Gasp in majors. But it's better than the typical scoreboard, in my opinion, at the end of every game. And if you want your advanced stats to improve, focus on making good grabs, focus on long holds when your team's trying to get returns, focus on winning pups, and obviously just winning the games, getting lots of returns and caps are going to boost you up and give you a higher Gasp and Nish every week. That is the end. There's some links here. I can share this PowerPoint so you can look through these. It's pretty amazing how much stuff has been written about Tag Pro. There's a lot of people a lot smarter than me who have thought about and have all these theories and have a better sense of the game. So you don't have to reinvent the wheel. You can learn from people that have already played this for a long time. Flaccid Trip says kill death ratio is super powerful in manipulating Nish. So if you want good stats, don't ever pop backs. And then we do have Spheroid's complex league theory here. Let's click on it real quick. Complex. This is my this was what I had for Spheroid as a joke. So that's everything I got. If anybody's got questions, feel free to hop in. If not, we will end for tonight. Thanks, guys. I don't know if anybody had any other questions, but thanks again for tuning in. I'm sure we'll upload it to YouTube shortly.
Everybody, give Russ a nice silent round of applause. What a presentation!
Thank you. Thank you, Flaccid. Appreciate it. Felt like I talked a lot, and I don't know that what I'm talking about half the time. But tune in next week. And good luck in your games this week, everybody.